أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Lesson number 239, Surah Sad, Ayah number 1 to 26. Surah Sad is a Makki Surah. It means it was revealed before Hijrah. Remember that the Quran is both Makki and Madani. What does it mean by Makki? That part of the Quran that was revealed before Hijrah, and Madani is that part of the Quran which was revealed after the Hijrah. So the division of Makki and Madani, is it by place or time? It's by time, right? It's not by place. So even if something was revealed after Hijrah in Makkah, then what would it be? Madani, right? So this division is by Zaman and not by Makan. And the primary lesson of this surah is submission to Allah and turning to Allah in repentance, in obedience. And this surah is named Sad. After what? After the Harf Muqatta'ah, which comes right at the beginning of the surah. And there are three surahs of the Quran that are named after Haruf Muqatta'ah. Which ones are they? Sad, Qaf, and Noon. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The surah is to be begin with Bismillah, which is, as you know, a mustaqilla ayah of the Quran, meaning it is a continuous verse which is recited at the beginning of every surah except for Surah At-Tawbah. And what is the purpose of beginning the surah of the Quran with Bismillah? What's the reason behind that? A'udhu Billah, understandable, right? That you're seeking refuge with Allah against shaitan. But why do you have to say Bismillah when you begin reciting a surah of the Quran? When you begin anything that is important, when you begin anything that is good, that is important, how should you begin? By the mention of the name of Allah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-A'raf, ayah 180, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Allah has the most beautiful names, so call upon Him by these names. And when we say Bismillah, what do we say? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We mention three names of Allah. Why? For the purpose of barakah, seeking barakah. So every surah of the Quran except for Surah At-Tawbah is to be begun with Bismillah. Why? In order to seek barakah by the names of Allah, as that is a command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sad wal Quran idhi dhikr. Sad, by the Quran containing reminder, containing dhikr. Sad is harf muqatta'ah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best about its meaning. And the reason behind this is because Sad, the harf Sad, is of the huruf hija'iyah, which in the Arabic language does not carry any literal meaning. Isn't it so? The huruf hija'iyah, the Arabic alphabet, do they have a meaning? They do not have any meaning. Now some people, they have appointed meanings to these huruf, and they have said that they are perhaps the names of Allah, or they are the names of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the names of the Quran, but there is no evidence to support that. And what seems most appropriate is the statement of Mujahid. And who was Mujahid? The Mufassir of his time. He said that these huruf, huruf muqatta'at, they do not have a meaning. So it's incorrect for us to say that they are the names of Allah or they are the names of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what's the evidence behind that? That these huruf do not have a meaning? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Shu'ara, ayah 192-195, that وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. This Qur'an is a revelation of the Lord of the worlds. نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينَ. The Ruhul Ameen, the trustworthy spirit, has brought it down. عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنْزِرِينَ بِلِسَانٍ عَرَبِيٍّ مُبِينٍ. That this Qur'an has been revealed in clear Arabic language. So what does it show? That every word of the Qur'an is what? Arabic. Isn't it so? And the huruf muqatta'at in the Arabic language, do they have a meaning? They do not have a meaning. What are they in the Arabic language? They are just huruf. Do you understand? Huruf hija'iyah, they are just huruf without any literal meaning. So it would be incorrect for us to appoint any meaning to these huruf. Do you understand? So we cannot say this is what they mean, that is what they mean, this is incorrect because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something otherwise. In the Arabic language, these huruf do not have any meaning. But then how is it possible that there is something that does not carry a meaning in the Quran? Because whatever does not have a meaning is what? Lagh. Useless, isn't it? Then how is it possible that there would be something without a meaning in the Quran? As we have learned earlier, these huruf, they have a purpose, and that is to display the miraculous nature of the Quran. And what's the evidence that these huruf display the miraculous nature of the Quran? Because every time these huruf come, what are they followed by? An ayah that exalts the Quran. You understand? This is the evidence that these huruf display the miraculous nature of the Quran. What is the evidence? That every time these huruf come, they are followed by a verse, a statement that exalts the Quran. So, Sad wal Qur'ani dhi dhikr. By the Quran, the dhikr, possessor of a dhikr. The, dhu, the, what does it mean? Possessor, sahib, one that contains, one that has. So, the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing an oath by it over here. And what is the description of the Quran given over here? What is the sifa? The dhikr. Meaning the Quran is possessor of dhikr. Now what does it mean by dhikr? How does the Quran contain dhikr? Dhikr, as you know, has several meanings. Of them is tadhkir. Tadhkir meaning reminder. So this Quran reminds people so that they can remember and they can learn. Isn't it so? The Quran has so much information, so many reminders. The concepts are mentioned repeatedly, reminding us why. So that we can remember, so that we can understand, so that we can learn. Because if something is mentioned only once, is it easy for you to remember it? No. But when something is mentioned repeatedly, then do you not remember it? Of course you do. When something is repeated, then you learn it. One is to just hear, and the other is to learn. So the Quran, because it is possessor of tadhkir, this is why it is a reminder. This is why we're able to learn. And what is the Quran a reminder of? What does it teach? It reminds people of the reality, of the truth, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in the fitrah of every single human being. Isn't it so? And what is that? That the purpose of our lives is the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took ahd alast. People come to this dunya, and what happens? They forget. Every child is born on fitrah. But what happens after some time? His beliefs are corrupted. Isn't it so? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent this Quran as a reminder of that fitrah. When we forget, the Quran reminds us. The Quran tells us. And the Quran is also a reminder of the rights and duties of people, the obligations that are on people. Secondly, the word dhikr also gives a meaning of maw'idah. Maw'idah meaning advice. Advice, how is the Quran possessor of advice, or how does it have advice? It is such advice by which people benefit. Isn't it so? The Quran is full of admonition, it's full of instruction, it's full of advice. And it's such advice that is beneficial. People benefit from it with regards to their worldly lives and also their spiritual lives. And there are many who offer advice, who offer instruction. But which is the most effective maw'idah? The most effective maw'idah? The Quran. Isn't it so? So many people say, I've heard so many lectures before. I've read many books before. But when I read the Quran, that is what touched me. That is what changed me. In Surah Al-Qamar, ayah 17, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ. And we have made the Qur'an easy for dhikr, meaning easy to take a lesson. Is there any who would take a lesson? Because the maw'idah in the Qur'an is very clear, direct, to the point, very effective. It has warning, it has good news, and that is why it has a very good effect on a person. Thirdly, the word dhikr also means over here mention. Mention, because dhikr is also to mention something or someone. So the Qur'an, the dhikr, meaning it contains mention. What does it mean by that? Meaning it has mention of who? People. This is what the Qur'an talks about. It is about people. It's about us. That is the subject of the Qur'an. In Surah Al-Anbiya, ayah number 10, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ كِتَابًا فِيهِ ذِكْرُكُمْ. We have certainly sent down to you a book in which is your mention. If you think about it, every book has some main topic, some main subject, some main theme. Isn't it so? That it discusses from the beginning all the way to the end. Now the Qur'an, what does it mention? Who does it talk about? Who is it for? Human beings. Isn't it so? All matters related to people are mentioned in the Qur'an. Whether it is about their worldly lives, or it is about their akhirah, guidance, misguidance, iman, kufr, all of that is mentioned where? In the Qur'an. So the Qur'an contains mention. Mention of who? People. And also the Qur'an contains mention of the past and also the future news. Isn't it? The people of the past, the prophets, the stories of the past, they are mentioned in the Qur'an. And the future, the day of judgment, hellfire, Jannah, all of that is also mentioned in the Qur'an. What other mention is there in the Qur'an? Of laws, commands, sharia. So the Qur'an is the dhikr. Fourthly, dhikr over here also means sharaf. What does that mean? Honor. So the Qur'an, it contains, it has sharaf. Meaning it is a source of honor for the one who lives by it. The one who lives by the Qur'an will bring honor to him. Where? In this dunya and also in the hereafter. Isn't it so? What did Umar radiallahu anhu say? That we were of the most disgraced of people. Isn't it? Who were the Arabs? Who were they known by? What culture did they have? What influence did they have on the world? Nothing. We were of the most disgraced of people, and Allah granted us honor with this Islam. Now whenever we seek honor in other than that which Allah honored us with, Allah shall disgrace us once again. So how did the Arabs get their honor? Through what? Through this religion, through the Qur'an. So this Qur'an is a source of honor for the one who lives by it in this dunya, and then also in the akhirah. How in the akhirah? That a person who reads the Qur'an, the person who has memorized the Qur'an, a person who lives by the Qur'an, what will happen? The Qur'an will come and intercede for him. And what will the person be told? Read and ascend. So a source of honor in dunya, in akhirah. In Surah Al-Zukhruf, ayah 44, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّهُ لَذِكْرٌ لَكَ وَلِقَوْمِكَ. And indeed, this Qur'an is a dhikr for you and also for your people. Meaning it is a source of honor for you and for your people. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gained honor through the Qur'an. Isn't it so? The qawm of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Arabs, how did they gain honor? Through the Qur'an. Fifth, dhikr also means dhikr of Allah. So the Qur'an, dhikr meaning it contains dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Through which one worships Allah. What are the different forms of dhikr? Istighfar, tasbih, tahmid, la ilaha illallah. There are different ways of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the ways of remembering Allah is by reciting the Qur'an. So just as a person worships Allah by saying Subhanallah, a person also worships Allah when he recites the Qur'an. فَالتَّالِيَاتِ ذِكْرًا. So, صَاد وَالْقُرْآنِ ذِكْرًا. By the Qur'an that is full of dhikr, that contains dhikr. And what are the five meanings of dhikr? First of all, تَذْكِير. Secondly, maw'idah. Thirdly, mention. Fourthly, sharaf. And fifth, dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now if you look in this ayah, an oath is being sworn. Isn't it so? Wal Qur'ani dhikr. And as you know, that a qasam has four things about it. What are they? Harf qasam. Secondly, the one who is swearing the oath, right? Thirdly, the maqsum alayh, the object by which you are swearing the oath. And fourthly, the jawab qasam. You need the response as well, you need the answer as well, right? Otherwise a qasam would be incomplete. Technically, four things are needed for a qasam. But over here we see that the jawab qasam has not been mentioned. Sad wal Qur'an idh dhikr balilladhina kafaru fi 'izzatin wa shiqaq. That's not jawab qasam. Grammatically it would not make sense. Now some have suggested different jawab for this qasam. Like for example, some have said that inna ilahakum lawahid, that your God is one God. Just as in the previous surah, the jawab qasam was that indeed your God is one God. Similarly, they have said that for this also, after the jawab qasam is that your God is one God. However, that would be confining the meaning, isn't it so? When you say that this is a jawab qasam, you're limiting the meaning. And in order to limit the meaning, you have to have some kind of evidence. But we have no evidence to support that. So other scholars, they have said that this qasam does not need a jawab qasam. It does not require a jawab qasam. Why? Because the purpose of this oath is to highlight the maqsum alayh. The purpose of this oath is to highlight the object by which the oath is being sworn. Because remember, I told you earlier that the maqsum alayh is always something that is very important. Isn't it so? Because then what's the point of swearing an oath by it? If it's not important, if it's not significant, there is no reason to swear by it. So the purpose of this oath is to highlight the importance of the maqsum alayh. And what is that? Al-Qur'an, the dhikr. The Qur'an that contains dhikr. And this is the case with some other aqsam in the Qur'an as well. Like for example, in Surah Al-Fajr, ayah 1-5, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears an oath by wal-fajr, wal-layalin ashr, wal-shaf'i wal-watr, wal-layli idha yasr. Hal fi dhalika qasamu lidhi hijr? And then there is no jawab. But what's the purpose over there? To highlight the importance of the time of fajr. To highlight the importance of those 10 nights. To highlight the importance of ash-shaf'i wal-watr, wal-layli idha yasr. You understand? So over here, the jawab is not needed because the qasam itself is meaningful. Okay? The oath itself is meaningful. And what's the meaning then? That this Qur'an has dhikr. And O people, you have been reminded. You have been reminded. This dhikr has come to you. At the end of Surah As-Safat, the people of Makkah were mentioned. That they would say, if only a scripture was revealed to us, we would be ibadallahi al-mukhlaseen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here that look, the dhikr has come. And this Qur'an is full of dhikr. It's full of reminder. It's full of mention. It's full of knowledge. But it's up to you now. What do you do? The dhikr has come. The reminder has come. Knowledge has come. What do you do? It's up to the people as to how they deal with this book. If they believe, if they follow the dhikr that is in this book, it's going to be for their own benefit. Because a person who lives by this book, he will gain honor in this dunya and the akhirah. And a person who rejects this book, turns away from this book, he will be humiliated, disgraced in this dunya and also in the akhirah. بَلِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا But those people who disbelieve, فِي عِزَّةٍ وَشِقَاقٍ They are in pride and dissension. Instead of accepting this dhikr, instead of living by this dhikr, look at their reaction. Instead of humbling themselves before this dhikr, they are in عِزَّةٍ وَشِقَاقٍ They are in pride and dissension. فِي عِزَّةٍ عِزَّةٍ is from the root letters عَيْن زَي زَي And izzah is a state that protects a person from being humiliated. A state of being honored, a state of having respect, a state of having the upper hand that protects a person from being humiliated, that protects a person from being disrespected. Like, for example, when a person has experience, does that give him izzah? Yes. When a person has a particular position in a company, does that give him izzah? It does. And because of that izzah, will he be respected? Of course. Can anyone dare to disrespect him? No. So izzah is a state that protects a person from being humiliated and disrespected. From the same root is ardun azaz. Ardun azaz, ard, land, that is azaz, is such land that is hard, that is tough, rocky ground, that is impossible to dig. So you cannot harm it, you cannot dig it. You understand? Just as a person who is aziz, you cannot harm them, you cannot disrespect them, you cannot cause any loss to them. Now sometimes izzah is used in a positive way, and other times it's used in a negative way. When is it used in the positive way? What does it mean by that? When it is mentioned in a praiseworthy manner, it is when izzah is a means of strength for its possessor. It is a means of strength for its possessor. Like at the end of Surah As-Saffat, we learn, Subhana Rabbika Rabbil Izzah, the Lord of Izzah. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of Izzah, it's a means of strength for Him. Similarly, we learn, فَإِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. But when Izzah is used in the negative sense, in a blameworthy manner, what does it mean? It gives the meaning of self-glory. It gives the meaning of pride. It gives the meaning of arrogance. A state in which a person does not accept the truth. So, izzah is negative when it prevents a person from accepting the truth. Do you understand? It's positive when it is a means of strength for its possessor. It's negative when it prevents him from accepting the truth. In Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 206, we learn, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُ اتَّقِ اللَّهَ أَخَذَتْهُ الْعِزَّةُ بِالْإِثْمِ. Positive or negative? Negative. Why? Because when he is told, fear Allah, his izzah comes in the middle, right? And it seizes him. So it prevents him from accepting the truth. It prevents him from benefiting from the advice that is given. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, بَلِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فِي عِزَّةٍ, that the disbelievers, they are in izzah, what does it mean? What does it mean by that? They are in pride, arrogance, self-conceit. They think too highly of themselves. And because of that, they are too arrogant to accept faith. They are too arrogant to believe in and follow the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because to believe and follow the Messenger, what do you need? Humility, isn't it? You have to give up. You have to surrender. But they were not willing to surrender. So fi izzatin, they are in arrogance, in pride, in disdain of faith and following the Messenger. Instead of following, they want to be followed. They refuse to submit. Wa shiqaq, and also opposition. Shiqaq from the root letter sheen qaf qaf, shaq. And shaq is to break something. In shaqqat. And shaqqa is to oppose. Why? Because when there's a group of people, right, and they break apart, why would they break apart into two? When there's some differences. And when they have broken apart, when there's disunity, when they have divided up, will they oppose one another? Of course. Will they compete with one another? Of course. So shiqaq is opposition, division. Okay? It is when both parties are opposing one another. So what does it mean by this? That the disbelievers are in shiqaq, meaning they are in disagreement with the Messenger of Allah and what he has brought. And this is not just disagreement, but also enmity. They are averse to what Allah has revealed. They do not accept it. So it is as though they are in one shiq and what Allah has revealed is another shiq. You understand? They are away, apart from what Allah has revealed. They stay away from it. They keep away from it. Just as a rock has been broken into two pieces, one piece is separate from the other. So similarly, these disbelievers, they are separate, away from what Allah has revealed. They don't have any interest in it. They don't want to listen to it. They don't want to accept it. They don't want to follow it. And also it has been said that بَلِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فِي عِزَّةٍ وَشِقَاقٍ. Shiqaq also means over here that they are in shiqaq among themselves. They are in disunity, discord, a split amongst themselves even. Because when the Prophet ﷺ claimed prophethood, what was the reaction of the disbelievers? Some people, they called him sahir. Others, they called him kahin. Others, they called him kadhib. So in their position against the Prophet ﷺ, they themselves were not united. Isn't it so? And if you look at all of the disbelievers of the world, from that time until today, isn't it that some people have said one thing about the Prophet ﷺ and others have said completely different things about him? Isn't it? Even they are not united in their opinion about the Prophet ﷺ. Some have said he was very honest, it was just a jinn who used to come to him. Some have said he learned from these Roman and Christian slaves who lived in Makkah. Others have said he was very intelligent, right? So, fi izzatin wa shiqaq. In Surah Al-Hashr, Ayah 14, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَحْسَبُهُمْ جَمِيعًا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ شَتَّى. You think that these disbelievers are united? No. Their qulub, their hearts are disunited, they're separate. So, الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, they seem to be one big group, but in reality, how are they? In shiqaq. So what do we learn from this ayah? That the disbelievers, those who disbelieve in the Messenger, they turn away from the dhikr, they turn away from the Qur'an, despite the fact that it's a source of great benefit for them. And what is the reason of their turning away? Pride. Arrogance. Fear izzatin. And also because they are in discord about it. This is something that has always been the case. That those who disbelieve have been in opposition to the Messenger of Allah. No matter who he was, whether he was Nuh a.s. or he was Lut a.s., people who disbelieve have always opposed the Messenger. And after the Messenger, who have they opposed? The heirs of the Messenger, meaning the scholars. And also the followers of the Messenger, meaning the believers. So, بَلِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فِي عِزَّةٍ وَشِقَاقٍ. This has always been the case, and this will remain the case. That those who disbelieve, they are in shiqaq, opposition. And what's the reason behind that? Pride. That they think if we believe, if we accept, we will become small. But the fact is that honor is in believing in this book, following this book. But look at how shaitan deceives people. That if you believe in this book, if you follow this book, then you will lose your leadership. You will lose your authority. You will lose your power. The same fitna the mushrikeen of Makkah went through, and the same fitna many other people go through. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us, كَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ مِنْ قَرْنٍ. How many a generation have we destroyed before them? كَمْ, over here, shows كَثِيرًا, meaning there's so many. أَهْلَكْنَا, we destroyed, مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ, before them. Before them, who does them refer to? أَلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And which أَلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا? Those at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. That before these people of Makkah, so many we destroyed, مِنْ قَرْنٍ, of generations, of past communities. So many generations of the past communities Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed before them. Why? For their disbelief. So the one who destroyed the people before them for their disbelief, is it not possible for him to destroy these people if they disbelieve? Is it not possible for him to do the same? Of course. So in this is warning that Allah destroyed so many generations before, and if you disbelieve, He can easily destroy you as well. In Surah Al-Hajj, Ayah 45, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَكَأَيِّمْ مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا وَهِيَ ظَالِمَةٌ فَهِيَ خَاوِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ عُرُوشِهَا وَبِئْرٍ مُعَطَّلَةٍ وَقَصْرٍ مَشِيدٍ. And how many a city did we destroy while it was committing wrong? So it is now fallen into ruin. And how many an abandoned well, and how many a lofty palace. So many palaces they built, but now they are in ruins. So many wells, sources of water they had, but now they are abandoned. In Surah Al-Anbiya, Ayah 11, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَمْ قَصَمْنَا مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ كَانَتْ ظَالِمَةً وَأَنْشَأْنَا بَعْدَهَا قَوْمًا آخَرِينَ. And how many a city which was unjust have we shattered and produced after it another people. So if Allah destroyed the previous people, can He not destroy them? Of course He can. And the previous people, when the adab came to them, فَنَادَوْا, so they called out. They called out on who? They called out on Allah for help. Or they called out on each other for help, for assistance. When the punishment came, they began calling out for help. Or they began loudly claiming belief. Like Fir'aun. What happened when the punishment came upon him? He claimed that he was a believer. فَنَادَوْا. So many people of the past, at the time when the punishment came, فَنَادَوْا. In Surah Ghafir, Ayah 84, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا رَأَوْ بَأْسَنَا قَالُوا آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَحْدَهُ وَكَفَرْنَا بِمَا كُنَّا بِهِ مُشْرِكِينَ. And when they saw our punishment, they said, we believe in Allah alone, and disbelieve in that which we used to associate with Him. So when the punishment came, nadaw, they proclaimed iman. We believe in Allah, and we disbelieve in all those partners that we were associating with Him. In Surah Al-Anbiya, Ayah 12, we learn, فَلَمَّا أَحَسُّوا بَأْسَنَا إِذَا هُمْ مِنْهَا يَرْكُضُونَ. And when they perceived our punishment, at once they fled from it. In Surah Al-Mu'minun, Ayah 64-65, حَتَّى إِذَا أَخَذْنَا مُتْرَفِيهِمْ بِالْعَذَابِ إِذَا هُمْ يَجْأَرُونَ. Until when we seize their affluent ones with punishment, at once they are crying to Allah. فَنَادَوْا. They begin to cry out to Allah. But Allah says, لَا تَجْأَرُوا الْيَوْمِ إِنَّكُمْ مِنَّا لَا تُنصَرُونَ. Do not cry out today. Indeed, by us you will not be helped. فَنَادَوْا. They called out. But Allah says, وَلَا تَحِينَ مَنَاصٍ. وَلَا تَ. And it was not. حِينَ. A time. مَنَاصٍ. For escape. وَلَا تَحِينَ مَنَاصٍ. But it was not a time for escape. لَا تَ. It gives the meaning of laysa. What does laysa mean? Not. So lata also not. And the ta at the end that you see, this ta of feminine is for the purpose of mubalagha. What is it? For mubalagha. Just as in the word allama, you have the ta marbuta at the end for mubalagha. So lata not at all. Do you understand? No way. Lata. Some have also said that lata, the ta is for ta'nees, because sometimes words are made feminine in the Arabic language for various reasons. And for instance, the word summa is sometimes pronounced as summata. Okay? There's a ta that is put at the end. Similarly, rubba, rubba is pronounced as rubbata. So rubbata, summata, similarly, laysa, lata. Okay? And one opinion is that ta is for mubalagha. So lata, it was not. There was no way there was. Not at all. Hina, any time. Manasin, for salvation, for escape. Manasin is from the root letters Noon Wal Sad. And Nals is to run. It is to escape from one's enemy. You understand? To escape from one's opponent. And manas, manwas, actually, this is on the structure of maf'al, so it's either zarf or it is masdar, right? Or both. So manas can be understood as the place or time to escape, or we can even understand this as simply escape. So the punishment came on the people of the past, so many people of the past, and when the punishment came, فَنَادَوْا, they called out, screaming for help, or they called out, proclaiming belief. But Allah says, وَلَا تَحِينَ مَنَاصٍ, but then there was no time at all for escape, no chance of escape. no chance of being saved. Because if they proclaimed Iman at that time, was it the right time to accept Iman? No. If a person accepts Iman at that time when the punishment comes, then it's too late. وَلَا تَحِينَ مَنَاسِ It's not time for escape. You could only escape the punishment if you proclaimed, if you accepted before. But if they accept now when the punishment has come, then it's too late. There's no chance for escape. No chance of getting out. وَلَا تَحِينَ مَنَاسِ And when the punishment came, they called out on one another for help, but there was no chance of helping each other even. There was no chance of assisting each other even, taking one another out of the punishment of Allah. So in other words, they called out at a time when calling out was of no use. They called out, but they could not escape. They could not help themselves. And in this is a severe warning. For who? Primarily the Meccan disbelievers. That despite the fact that the example of the previous people is there, still they have not taken any lesson from them. And yet they have dared to disbelieve in the messenger and hurt him and call him bad names that people dislike. And this ayah is also a means of comfort for the Prophet ﷺ. That the previous people disbelieved, they denied, they opposed their messengers, they were too arrogant to submit, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took revenge from them. And this is also a warning against the deniers, that they cannot cause any harm to the messenger. Rather, if they disbelieve, they will be harmed. In Surah Fussilat, Ayah 15, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَمَّا عَادٌ فَاسْتَكْبَرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ As for Ad, they were arrogant upon the earth without right. فَاسْتَكْبَرُوا They were arrogant, right? Just as the people of Makkah, what was their problem? Fear izzatin. Any other disbelievers, what's their problem? Fear izzatin, too arrogant to submit. Long time ago, when the people of Ad lived, even they were too arrogant to submit. And in their arrogance, وَقَالُوا مَنْ أَشَدُّ مِنَّا قُوَّةً They said, who is greater than us in strength? Allah says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّ اللَّهَ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُمْ هُوَ أَشَدُّ مِنْهُمْ قُوَّةً Did they not see that Allah, the one who created them, He is mightier than them in strength? وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يَجْحَدُونَ And yet they used to reject our signs. And what happened? Were they punished? Of course they were. Could they escape the punishment? No. Despite their might, despite their strength, they were unable to save themselves.